not good at all each day. But I still need love, cause I'm just a man. These nights never seem to go to plan. I don't want you to leave, will you hold my hand? Oh, won't you stay with me? Cause you're all I need. This ain't love, it's clear to see. But darling, stay with me. I'm so emotional. No, it's not a good look, and some self-control. Deep down.
And good morning. You're listening to WJOB AM 1230 and 104.7 on the FM dial. It's the City of East Chicago show. I'm the host of the show, Verlie Suggs, and I have with me the newly re-elected mayor of the City of East Chicago, Mayor Anthony Copeland. Good morning, Mayor.
Good morning, Verlie. Something about that brought a smile to my face.
You know what? It brought a smile to my face that Tuesday night. Of course, I had no doubt in my mind that you would get reelected, but you know, I never count my chickens or eggs before they hatch, and so I was definitely elated.
Yes, thank you.
You worked very hard, and basically, I have to say, you've worked hard since you've been in office. So your campaigning was not just about campaigning. It was actually showing people what you've done.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I was once told, Verlie, to whom much knowledge is given, also much sorrow. This election was very difficult for me because I knew what was at stake. And just the future of the city. The city has been going in a good direction financially. We've been able to just set a straight and narrow course, and I just knew what was at stake. So during this whole election, it was just a heaviness on me because I knew what was at stake.
Well, a lot of citizens of East Chicago knew what was at stake as well, and they didn't want to go back to the past. They were moving forward and wanted to continue on that path. You know, let's talk about that, Mayor, because you've been in office how many years now?
In October, it'll be 9 years.
So 9 years you've been in office, and it's been a steady stream of progress. You drive through the City of East Chicago. It's clean. You see development taking place. You see the parks that are beautiful, city services that are second to none. So tell me about that path from the day you walked into that office 9 years ago until today, May 2019.
I can tell you that I inherit things almost on a biblical scale, like the plagues of Egypt.
Well, we can do this B.C. and A.C. We can do before Copeland and after Copeland.
Okay.
How's that?
Well, I can tell you that, of course, the city was $15 million in debt. The workers was on furlough day. Police and fire had taken a 5% cut. Out of the $15 million we got annually from gaming, $13 million of that was used to shore up the general fund. That's what I inherited. And slowly, we chipped away at that giant block of debt. And as each year went, it got better. It got better. And then when we completely severed our reliance on gaming, we were now able to take that $13 million and leverage it across projects, across other state and federal dollars. And slowly things started to get better,
Let me ask you this, because, you know, just to stop you there, you said you were able to get out of that debt and not depend on casino revenue. What were some of the things that you did that got you to that point where East Chicago was able to have a balanced budget plus a surplus?
Well, I would tell you that first we had to make the hard, fast decisions. We had to reduce the workforce, and we did that. We had to lay off. We probably laid off over 200, and I would say about between 200 and 250 employees. But the way we did it, we said that if you had 3 years or less, it was not who you knew or whatever. We say 3 years or less, you had to get laid off. So, and that was probably the hardest decision I ever had to make as mayor. Then from there,
Now, when you laid off these people, were these positions that were able to still, the services were still able to be provided without these individuals working?
No. It was difficult. It was difficult because whenever you have a reduction in a workforce, you're going to give, you're going to lose something. You know, it's boots on the ground thing when you want to keep a city clean. But as things got better, we supplemented with a part-time workforce, and that's what helped buffer up everything and allow us to go back to efficiently cleaning the city, maintaining the city.
Okay. So now you have a surplus. What does that mean for the city?
I would say that when I first came in, one of the sorriest positions I found myself in was when there were federal matches out there of 80-20. Federal government say, if fancy say you got $10, they say, give us two and we give you eight. And we couldn't even tap into those matching funds.
Because you didn't have the 20%
needed. Because we didn't have the 20%. But now, any and everything out there, we can match. And this is why you're starting to see the street projects coming. Any federal dollars out there, we can match. Any state dollars out there, we can match. Any developers that come in here that want us to put up a match, we're able to put up the match. I give you a good, for instance, on there, we're getting ready to put up a $40 million new senior building, or let me say senior complex.
Where's that going?
On Guthrie Street at 136 and Guthrie, all the open land between there and Main Street. It will fill that whole void. And we had a developer come in, and we were able to put $3 million of the city dollars into that project. And that's what I meant. Have matched that $3 million allowed us to obtain $37 million worth of development for a combined total of a $40 million development project.
That's amazing because you're not getting the seniors.
In the beginning, we would have never been able to do that.
Isn't that something? So does that mean the Nicosia building, is this where people are going to go that
yes.
were there? And
yes.
The Hunter building still or?
No, the Hunter building will stay. It's in very good condition.
Uh-huh.
This is to replace the Nicosia building.
Okay, fantastic. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the projects. What else? Because I noticed that there's some construction going on Indianapolis Boulevard. Street's pretty much torn up. What are they doing over there?
That's going to be a whitening, street whitening project. It's going to be a $14 million project where we will be completely giving Indianapolis a facelift. Right now, you got horrific parking problems all along that stretch. It's going to allow us to fix all of the parking in that area. It's a long time coming. We will be replacing all of the water lines along there, the sewer lines, separating the combined sewer system there. And this will take us into generations to come, the investment that we're making now.
That's fantastic. Now, also, I noticed
and we're doing the same thing on Guthrie Street. That's a $9 million project.
So Guthrie Street, the street that in the past administrations it was ignored, you're still putting lots of money into that area.
Yes. I would tell you that I remember this one commentator would always like to tell me about Guthrie being the worst street in East Chicago and this and that and that. I can tell you now Guthrie is probably one of the safest streets in East Chicago now.
Under your administration.
Yes. Another thing I can tell you that when I first came in, the city didn't enjoy a real close relationship with the federal government. Now all of the federal enforcement agencies, we have a very good relationship with them, and it has allowed us to be more aggressive and protecting the public when we've combined all these agencies together, and we have a benefit from that for crime going down 7 years in a row. And we've looked at the first quarter projections, and if we stay true to those projections, you're looking at crime possibly going down 8 years in a row in the city of East Chicago.
That's amazing. And then also your crime solve rate.
Yes.
Is like almost
100%,
I believe.
Yes, yes.
So that's a kudos to your leadership as well as Chief Smith and the police department over there.
And you're right for bringing up that fact. There was a time that murders was going unsolved in the city of East Chicago. When I came in, I think it was about 13 that was unsolved, and all of those have been solved. Again, but that's having that relationship with the federal government. Instead of closing our boundaries or our doors to them. Open it, let them come in, work together. And Becker brought that spirit in when he was chief. He brought that spirit in of showing us how we could benefit by having a closer relationship with the ATF, with the DEA, you know, with the FBI, and it has paid dividends.
Fantastic.
So I have to attribute it to Chief Becker.
So when we talk about public safety, of course, I had Fire Chief Cerner here last month, and talking about your fire department and the new equipment that's yes. there and the programs with the beds for babies and yes. those sort of things mm-hmm. all being implemented under your administration.
Yes. And Verlie, I can remember back when I was Cerner's captain. And if you would have asked me, would he ever be chief? I would have said, no way. And then if you would have asked me, hey, man, do you know the future? Say you're going to make them chief. I would have questioned somebody's sanity. But do you know that's probably one of the best department heads that I have? I'm very thankful. He's proactive in the community. He's taking his guys into community. They're reading to the children. They're being interactive all in the community. So it's just been a blessing all the way around.
Fantastic. So as we look at the city of East Chicago and Klein Avenue being rebuilt, I saw a lot of those structures that are, you have them housed like in one of the former mill sites.
Yes.
And so it's just like piece by piece putting it together.
Like putting up Lego blocks. And if you look at it, we're in May, and they projected to finish in January. You can see how quick they're going to assemble it. You know, it's just made to interlock until you go across that span.
That's amazing. Now, you know, I drove through Marktown last week, and of course, I know Paul Maher is probably listening. Shout out to
yes.
Paul.
Oh, yeah.
No offense, yes. Mayor, but he's the mayor of Marktown.
Yes, yes, he is. Hey, I can see that. I can see it. Before I even became mayor, one of the best educations I got on a section of East Chicago was from Paul Myers. Well, he told me the whole complete history of Marktown and all like that, and how we have to set the path to restore Marktown. And going into next year, the same aggressive program that we got in Sunnyside, where we're completely restoring the duplexes over there. And Sunnyside, on each side of the duplex, we give each one of them $40,000 for exterior restoration. And we're getting ready. We got the program. We're getting ready to launch it in Marktown, and we will be doing the same aggressive program in Marktown.
That's fantastic. I know he's very, as well as the rest of the residents, are yes. happy about that. I mean, Marktown looks beautiful now because, I mean, the streets are clean just like everywhere else in the city. And grass
is
green.
You pick up the trash. Your grass get cut. Look at the parks. The investment
we're gonna
put in the parks.
I even see a police officer stationed right over there. Yes. You know, 24/7, catching any speeders, I guess, coming from U.S., mm-hmm. Not U.S., but the oil company, BP.
BP.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And we got major road work coming down there in the Dickey Road stretch. We've been wrestling for the last 3 years. I wanted a roundabout in that intersection right there. And now I think we've come to agreement that it may just be restoring the road and just put a couple more turnoffs to where you only can enter into Dickey Road one way and not go through Marktown. But anyway, I don't care if it's the roundabout I want or another design. We know we're getting ready to enhance the traffic flow going through Marktown.
So at this point, East Chicago has two roundabouts, one at Inland Steel. Or
yes.
Get out of Inland Steel, but of course it's Arsenal Middle. And the one at the entrance at Columbus Drive.
Yes.
I mean, beautifully done. I mean, the yes. florals and just a great entry to the city of Chicago.
And, you know, we put that sculptural feature there. Now we're getting ready to tie in the LED lights. At night when you come, you'll see it illuminating in multiple colors. I tell everybody in the next couple of years, when you see the sculptural features that we're going to be putting in our parks and throughout our main thoroughfares, you're going to see that art. It's a reason why art enhances a civilization. And I tell everybody, it's nothing wrong when you ride around your city that you see beautiful things. Beauty begat beauty. And it makes a sense of ownership. It makes a sense of pride. And these are the things that we're going to be instilling across our city in the next couple of years.
And one of the campaigns that the city of East Chicago has done is about I Love My City.
Yes.
And that definitely has taken off.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. From banners, T-shirts, to poster contests, just everything. It's been a complete buy-in from the smallest to the tallest. And it's one of the programs that I'm really happy about because it has brought all of us together.
That's fantastic. Any plans for the side of the former housing complex in Calumet?
Yes. Right now, we're talking. I'm working with Don and Karen, and we're having developers come and talk to us.
And we're talking about Don and Karen from Economic Development.
Yes,
for,
I'm sorry. Yes. Yes.
Well, we all know Don Collins,
yeah, well,
Karen.
First name.
Right, yeah, but definitely for those listeners who are not familiar.
Yes. Right now, we're going to be putting up, I said, between 8 to 10 model homes in the Calumet area to show them things to come.
So is this going to be on the land that's already been remediated?
Yes. Yes. It's okay. Going to be in zones 2 and 3. Mm-hmm. Because these areas have already been cleaned up. And we're working with the state, with the Indiana Department of Housing, and we're going to put these model homes there, and it's going to be to show people the things to come. That this is what we're working on as I speak.
Fantastic. Now, when we look at jobs in the city of East Chicago, mm-hmm. are there any more businesses that are planning to come in? Any more jobs being provided for the residents?
Right now, one of the things we're working on is at the old DuPont site. We have developers coming in there.
Now, that's right off Kennedy Avenue.
Yes.
We're talking about.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if that pans out, we're looking at literally thousands of jobs that will be available for people from East Chicago. It would be a duplication of what we did when we brought Hoist in here. And when we brought Hoist in there, it brought in like 500 jobs here in the region. That's what this development will do. And also what I'm proud of is we're putting together now, I'm working with a company, I can't reveal it all, but I'm working with a company where we're going to be offering an apprenticeship program. And the success rate of bringing in minorities into this apprenticeship is like a 40% increase over what your traditional unions are doing when it comes to bringing minorities into the training programs. So that's something also that we're working on. And we will be able to produce welders, pipe fitters, crane operators. So this is something that we're probably going to be unveiling in about 2 weeks or less.
Fantastic. So you have new community centers in the city of East Chicago.
Yes.
Any talk yet about a new grocery store coming in?
Well, we're working on that, but I try to tell citizens of East Chicago that you have to have developers to come in to do that. The city cannot build a grocery mm-hmm. store. You have to have developers come in. They do traffic counts, and then they have to legitimize where they want to put their grocery store. This is something that you can't force down. But at the same time, in the city of East Chicago, you have free bus transportation that you can go anywhere across the city. We have a major a store in Strax.
How has East Chicago been able to keep having free bus service, health department, city courts, all the things that neighboring communities are getting rid of? How has East Chicago been able to maintain that?
I'm going to double back on that, but let's not forget we have Forte Market. I mean, that has very good meat, very good produce. Then we also have one in the middle of the niche, Johnny's Meat Market. It's not like we devoid of going to have a place. And then you always got the little mom and pop little things on the corner.
So you
want to
keep those small businesses in operation.
The point I'm making is that let's not put it out there like East Chicago is devoid of
so there's no food desert in East Chicago.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah,
we got that straight. Everyone's just used to that Columbus Drive.
They may want two and to be an oasis, but it certainly ain't a desert.
Okay, that's fine. I can see that.
And when it comes to like the free bus transportation, I could have wiped that out. When I was struggling, when we was $15 million in debt, I could have waved my hand and made the free buses disappear. I could have waved my hand and got rid of the health department. But you have to weigh the importance of what it brings. I look around, you have a lot of people that don't have a car, or you have seniors that can't drive, or you have younger people that are not eligible to drive. And when I look at how that bus is going round and round, and it can take you one part of town to another part of town, and it allows us to entrap those dollars and keep them within our city. When I weigh that against getting rid of the bus service or being able to take people to other parts of the city where they can still keep the money in the city, it outweighed me getting rid of it. It was just too valuable, the transportation to get rid of. And then also with the health department, when you look at proactively, we can gauge the health of our community or our city. It's invaluable to have the health department. It's the first indicator that something is going wrong in your community when you can judge its health on how healthy your community is. And just think about it. We would have had to handle the lead crisis totally different if we didn't have a health department. By having our health department, we were able to even test our population, you know, and they could come to one place and get tested. You know, bring their kids, get on that same free bus and bring their kids to get tested. So it all tied in. So that's why I've never even thought for 1 minute to get rid of any of those services.
So, Mayor, just recently you had an election in the city of Chicago. There's going to be some new people sitting on the city council. Mm-hmm. You, of course, in the same role as mayor of the city. How do you think it's going to be for you moving forward, trying to continue with the progress that the city has been able to implement so far, mm-hmm. and with new leadership on the council?
Well, Verlie, the one thing I've never tried to do, I've respected the three tiers of government, you know, the legislative, executive, and the judicial. I've never tried to run the council. I put my ordinances together. I send them over there, the resolutions. They can vote them up. They can vote them down. You know, I've never tried to just manipulate, make sure I had the votes and all like that. So I think maybe the way I look at the council may be different the way other mayors look at a council. But I can tell you that the people have spoken. I can tell you that the people are not going to stand for foolishness of when something go over there and it benefit or is going to enhance the whole city. They're not going to go for them just to just knock things down just because they can. I just don't think that atmosphere will exist. I think we got some new people that's ready, willing, and able to continue the path that we're going in. I've been able to talk to a few of them, and I'm very pleased with the way that they're speaking on and the way that they're viewing the future of the city of East Chicago. So I'm happy. I mean, I think that there's promise there.
So is East Chicago still a city of hope and progress?
Always.
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 I like that.
And when we put the statue feature there, it has a 30-foot section, and we say that 30-foot section is our past. Then it has a 40-foot section, and we say that's our present. Then it has a 50-foot height or section, and that's our future. So, again, it ties into hope and progress.
Fantastic. Families. How are you getting families to come in and buy a home in the city of Chicago?
Right now, really, I remember when I first became mayor, I had an individual that lived further south from here, was just trying to talk down on the city of East Chicago. I tell people, you can live wherever you want to, but if you choose not to live in East Chicago, you can't damn us because you think where you live at. I tell everybody, you look, no matter where you look at, from here to the White House, you look hard enough, you find cracks in the armor, you find things wrong. But you can't tear down another city to try to uplift another one. It just don't work that way in life, you know. And I remember that individual telling me, don't nobody want to live in East Chicago, you know what I mean? Well, I beg to differ. I looked at that. It said gnawing at me. And so we put incentives there to where if you build brand new in the city of East Chicago, we give you $25,000 down. If you're a city worker, we give you $30,000. If you buy an existing home, we give you $10,000 down. And if you're a city worker, we give you $15,000. And I'm happy to report this program is 4 years old, and we have 280 new homeowners in the city of East Chicago.
Is this a loan program or
no,
is it?
No, it's forgivable.
It's a forgivable.
Forgivable. The existing one, you have to reside in home for 5 years. In the new home, I want to say 7 years, I think it is.
Okay, mm-hmm. Fantastic. Well, one thing about the city of East Chicago is they always have something going on. I saw the billboards for the Rhythm and Soul over there by St. Catharines, but a lot of things happening in the city of East Chicago. Mm-hmm. How do we manage?
How we what?
How do you manage to do all this?
Because you know what? We find that the more, like we had a movie night last night at Tide Park. And we find that the more things that you put together that brings families together, that bring the community together, the dividend that comes off of that is immense. So we have found that put these community-oriented things together, let people come together, let them interact, and then they get to know each other, they get to have a good time together, they get to do things with their children, and like I say, it just has an uplifting effect.
Well, you know, as I look, Mayor Anthony Copeland, of course, you mentioned the movie night last night, but there's a movie night on June 27th,
yes.
The Lego Movie 2.
Yes.
How to Train a Dragon on Thursday, July 25th, Spider-Man mm-hmm. Into the Spider-Verse on August 22nd, and Ralph Breaks the Internet on September 26th. So
yes.
This is a whole movie series for
yes.
the summer.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have the East Chicago Rhythm and Soul Fest on June 15th.
We have our Teen Bash. We have our Fusic Fest
coming
up.
Oh, my goodness. Tell us about the Teen Fest. You're not forgetting the teens in East Chicago.
No. At the Teen Bash, I know I have attended maybe three of them that I can think off the top of my head. And it gives me an opportunity to interact with the teens, in which if I don't go into the schools, I probably never really interact with them in a different environment. And it has paid dividends because of the investment that we've made out at our lakefront. We've been trying to say, how do we now bring that next generation, expose them to the lakefront so they can enjoy it for years and years to come? And this was part of that hook. Just like when we added canoeing, kayaking, paddle boating, out at the lakefront. So we've been trying to get pull the community back into the lake, because there was for years and years when
the
casino came.
Because you know there are people who don't live in the community who are coming there. And when I was at the beach last summer, a couple that were there was saying, "Oh, this is the best secret. No one knows." You know, they're coming in from Chicago to come to East Chicago to go to the beach.
Yes, and you know what, Verlie? Just like across the city, I try to get the city workforce to see that when your city is clean, people will say your city is safe. They will be, when your city is dirty, they attribute that to crime, associated with crime, this and that. You get the opposite effect when your city is clean. When you come out there to the beaches, we comb the beaches 3 times a week. We have the wild goose chase where the dogs come and run the geese and the gulls away from the water
so
the bacteria
so
calms down.
Right.
But everything is based on constantly keeping your parks clean, keeping your lakefront clean, the places where people go to enjoy with their family. Keep those places pristine, and you will see the residual effect that comes off of it.
That's definitely happening in the city of East Chicago. Also, what's happening at the golf course?
Myra Acosta, the new park director, she put this together. Say one of the hidden gems we got is MacArthur Park with the golf course that we got there. I think it's a par 5.
Par 8.
It's a 9-hole.
It's a 9-hole. Okay.
Thank you, Steve Segura.
But it still have a par to it. I just don't know what par. That is one of those hidden gems that we have. We keep it manicured. We keep it clean, everything. And so then she's putting things together to bring the people into the golf course. And this is where there's spirit at MacArthur. She's going to have where you can have wine tasting. You can go out and play some rounds of golf. And at the same time, we're going to have a band there and just create a different atmosphere in that space.
That's fantastic. Well, I know there's a calendar of events for the city of East Chicago, and I'm sure there are a number of places where people can pick these up.
Yes.
And see some of the events that are taking place throughout the summer, the Fusic Fest, and all the great things happening in the city of East Chicago, just truly
and
moving forward.
And at our Fusic Fest, I'm giving a shout-out on Sunday. We're going to have Ramon Ayala, just a great just a giant in the Mexican music world. He's going to come here. Man, I mean, our Facebook page has been rocking. That's from people saying, I'll be there. So Sunday, we already know on our Fusic Fest, our three-day fest, is going to be packed.
Now, does East Chicago go into the hole when they do these festivals? I mean, are you, like, is it going into debt to do these things? Or
no, you know what? I tell people, it's tomato, tomato. It's a yin and a yang. You got to own, whenever you do something, you got to say, what am I getting back off of it? We bringing people, exposing them to our lakefront. We bringing our community into our lakefront. Everything is to draw attraction to our lakefront, because all of our major festivals now, we're taking them out of our park and they're all being held at the lakefront. That's going to be our main venue. We just put a permanent stage up there, Verlie. We don't have to rent a stage. We put our own stage
That's
up.
Fantastic.
So it's to bring all the attractions. We have picnic shelters out there. We have a splash pad out there.
I love the splash pad.
We put all of the amenities where you can come and have a great time. So I really don't even think festivals are really shouldn't be used in the public domain to just say, I'm trying to make a profit. Because if you do that, then you will truly fail.
Exactly.
So I think if you make a profit, you do. But if you don't, if you successfully bring people together, they have a good time, they leave, they come in a safe environment, they leave, exit out of a safe environment, everybody go home peacefully. I think if you create that, I mean, you couldn't get a better ambassador from an event to promote your city. You just couldn't.
Well, Mayor, our time has come to an end, and of course, I want you to look at the residents of East Chicago who are tuning in on the government channel. I want to thank Steve Segura from Multimedia, as well as Ryan Lomax, and tell the residents of East Chicago what you want to tell them.
I would like to tell them thank you for entrusting me to continue doing the greatest job in the world. You have unbelief when you're doing something. There was moments that I doubted this, I doubted that. But East Chicago, thank you for restoring the hope that I have. Thank you for letting me know that you're seeing the progress in our city. And thank you for sending that message to all of Northwest Indiana that thought that they was going to see a fist fight, a drag out, a knockout, and we was going to be acting in an unethical way. We didn't. Smoke cleared. Thank you for letting me still be standing in East Chicago. I will continue to serve you with all of my heart, my soul, my kidney, my pancreas, all that I am. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. This has been the City of East Chicago Show. Stay tuned for Veterans Views, our award-winning veterans program here on WJOB AM 1230 and 104.7 FM. See you next time.